Senate Democrats' reconciliation bill would extend child tax credits into 2025, giving families much-needed post-COVID relief. Senator Marco Rubio has deemed the plan a, quote, poverty trap that will go to parents who are simply not working at all. A senior GOP aide told Emily Jasinski that, quote, some Republicans are a bit reluctant to criticize the plan. Joining us now to discuss this further is culture editor at The Federalist, Emily Jasinski. Emily, welcome back. Great to have you here.
It's good to be here. Good to see everyone.
So what are you hearing from people? We talked about this child tax credit a bunch while you were here in the chair opposite me. It's something that, you know, a lot of conservatives have supported, but are getting a little bit skeptical about what they can say about it publicly. What are you learning?
Well, I think Rubio does make a pretty good point that calling it a tax credit is a little bit difficult because it's really a child allowance. And on the left, that should be great. I mean, that should be great news because it's a program that people on the left really believe is going to reduce child poverty significantly. But it's not really a tax credit because you don't have to have, as Rubio suggests in this memo that I reviewed for this piece at The Federalist, you don't even have to have tax liability to be eligible for this. And that does mean it'll go to people who aren't working. It does mean there's no marriage requirement. And so on the right, people are starting to think really hard about what some of these programs that are intended and they love because it does, a lot of people on the right are concerned about the birth rate. A lot of people on the right are concerned about people not having children. And so there's, I think, just trying to figure out what to think about this. Zed Jelani had a really interesting tweet in response to the line that I tweeted out. The senior Republican aide had told me that Republicans are a bit reluctant to criticize the plan. Zed was like, this is a huge change from the welfare politics of the 1990s. And again, if you love programs like this, great. If you don't, it's just interesting to see Republicans be a little bit hesitant to wade into a debate they would have relished previously.
Yeah, one thing, Emily, that's interesting from your piece, you quote, let me see here, Rubio and Lee saying that, quote, while maintaining the essential connection between receiving the credit and working, right? So they're and Rubio and Lee saying an essential part of being pro-family is being pro-work, right? I found that to be particularly interesting because, you know, traditionally, conservatives had advocated for a stay-at-home parent. And now, if you say this money is only going to be given to you if you have a job, then you're sort of, I mean, for me, I think this should be extended to everybody and it shouldn't matter at all what your income is because it would potentially facilitate people to be able to stay home with their children more if they so wanted to. So do you think that sort of attitude of, you know, you got to work, and then that sort of takes parents out of the home. Do you think that also might be something that is going to go against Republicans?
Yeah, it's interesting, and that's what they have to figure out. And Rubio and Lee came out in opposition to a plan that Mitt Romney had advanced in February that similarly didn't have a work requirement. And so the fact that Rubio was circulating this memo now about the extension of the child allowance in the reconciliation resolution that just passed, it's really interesting because he's then making the same arguments. He even uses Joe Biden's words against him about dependency and what Bill Clinton, the way that Bill Clinton and Joe Biden talked about that in the 90s. But Ryan and I actually had Blake Masters on the show, who's running in Arizona for Senate. And he came on and talked about how he believes that, you know, you should be able to have a middle class family on one parent's income and how that's not possible anymore. And the federal government should figure out a way to make that possible. And so Republicans are in this really interesting spot where they do want to pursue some of these programs that are pro-family. But they also still have this this belief in the dignity of work and the importance of work. So it's interesting because it's not a conversation about spending, you know, like it used to be. And that's what's sort of been fascinating to see is like we're not talking about this new entitlement that's going to bankrupt the country. Rubio talked about it in the context of trapping people in poverty. And about how being pro-work is being pro-family. So just even the way that it's being discussed is different and definitely interesting.
So, Emily, it's great to have you. And I was fascinated by your tweet that Republicans really were kind of hesitant to vocally come out against this because, in theory, and frankly, if you call it a tax credit, it's a lot more palatable than just saying it's a $3,000 handout to families. But let me ask you this, kind of looking over the horizon, I think a lot of Republicans have kind of, not to say turned a blind eye, but signed off on spending they wouldn't usually agree with because of COVID. So whether it was direct payments, PPP, unemployment insurance, and now this, do you see this as a trend where at some point they're going to say, yeah, that's enough, it's enough federal government quote-unquote handouts? Or do you think Republicans have kind of given up the fiscal conservatism fight with regard to these sort of entitlements?
Yeah, that's like the million-dollar question, or I should say like $25 trillion question, because it used to be, I mean, especially in the Tea Party years, that was such a feature of Republican politics. But after the Trump years, where there was, I mean, just tons of spending, and I mentioned that in the piece, just spending with abandon, there was big spending during COVID. And I see some people on the right sort of flirting with the idea of UBI, universal basic income, which Rubio actually criticized the Biden child allowance plan as being a precursor to UBI. I don't know. I mean, it's tough to say. I think it's still really there because I think actually people do care about that. Not everyone, but I do think there's a chunk of the population that does actually really care about the fiscal health of the country in that sense. And you can debate whether, you know, having a massive national debt is actually an indicator of fiscal health or not. But I think people do still care about that. I think to some extent, as these programs get bigger and bigger, I do think Republicans, it's still there, but it's definitely, people have to speak about it differently. And I think there's a mounting awareness of that you can't sort of wage these very 90s wars on welfare and welfare queens the way people used to.
And Emily, I'm glad you brought up that Blake Masters interview because I thought it really exposed in an interesting way some Democratic hypocrisy on this issue, or at least some very confused thinking from Democrats. You know, when he said, you know, that he wanted to encourage government support that would allow for, you know, a single parent, you know, middle class household, you know, he very specifically made sure not to make it gendered. And I think trying to kind of bait liberals into attacking him for kind of coding it as gendered. And he got what he wanted. Liberals piled on him. But if they're going to at the same time say that there should not be work requirements connected to this child tax credit, which I think is the correct position, but then also attack a Republican who supports not connecting work requirements to this type of support, are they hypocrites here, or are they just confused about where they are because we're evolving so quickly on these questions?
Yeah, I think they're confused about where they are. And I think that speaks to a broader confusion, the feminist movement, that informs the confusion in the Democratic Party about what women want and what the ideal family arrangement is. And for so many women, the ideal family arrangement that shows up in polling time and time and again is that women prefer to work part-time or not at all and be home with kids if they have kids. And so if you purport to be a movement for women, and if you purport to be pro-woman, you then sort of have to walk away a little bit or walk back a little bit the hashtag girl boss fervor. And I don't think the left is really fully equipped to do that yet because it's so governed by the yas queen girl bosses and the political establishment.
We think we can have it both. You know, that's the thing. We think we can. And COVID kind of shows us that we can with being able to work from home and have kids. And a lot of women are doing that. So
right.
I think
and,
that's
and everybody
kinda...
everybody should be able to. But then when you say that you're required to work, even if you're a single
right.
parent to get this help, progressives are extremely hostile to that position. And so then they should then reflect on what that means more broadly. But Emily, thank you so much for joining us here.
Thanks, guys.
And we'll have more Rising right after this as New York State Assemblyman Ron Kim joins us.